Hi, everybody. Julie Goodnight here, coming at you live from the living room for another daily dose of horsemanship homework. And I see good morning, Nancy Galleon in Southern California. You jumped on here really fast. And Nona, your mother, 90-year-old mother, is with you. Good morning, Nona. Hope you are well. That is known. I should have known Nancy wouldn't be on already. She's probably working. But thanks for jumping in there, Nona, right? First person on board. So Judy Snyder from Chicago, Illinois. Good morning. Elizabeth, good morning again. We've already been chatting online this morning. Elizabeth, one of my interactive students. We've been chatting about that naughty horse of yours. So you're welcome. It's great you guys are jumping on board with me again this morning. Again, while we're waiting for people to come on board, just to remind you, I've been coming at you with either a live post or a video recorded post every day for you to have a daily dose of horsemanship, so that if you are stuck at home and under stay-at-home orders, as we are here in Colorado and as many of you are across the nation and indeed across the world, and if you're feeling separated from your horses and your horse life, at least here's a way to connect. It's my opportunity to connect with you guys, my audience. I miss being on the road teaching horsemanship clinics. I miss the horse expos, doing presentations on numerous different subjects that I do at horse expos. So this is my opportunity to connect with you, and it's your opportunity to, I hope, learn a little bit about your horsemanship, have a better connection with your horse, have a more fulfilling and, most importantly, a safer relationship with your horse. So thank you guys for joining me. Today's lesson, I decided, you know, we needed to talk a little bit more about this relationship training thing. It's a big subject, and I've just had so many people lately who that paradigm shift. One of my students was talking about yesterday, made that paradigm shift in the way she thinks of her horse, and I suppose in the way she understands the horse's behavior and the horse's needs and wants and motivations and all that, and how you fit into that. Today's going to be part two of that lesson. And because of some of the great questions you guys asked yesterday, right at the end of our post, there were two questions that were really important. One from Susie Carriger there on the West Coast, Southern California again. And Susie asked, what do you do? Or I'm not sure exactly what this question meant, but it was something along the lines of, how do you help a horse that's asking for direction? Or when do you know a horse is asking for your help? And I'm not real sure I fully understand that question, but that's part of what got me thinking about this subject of relationship training and taking it one step further in terms of your relationship. The second question that got me thinking along this line came right at the end of my record long live post yesterday. That was, how do you make a horse go forward willingly without resistance? And the answer to that question is a very, very big answer, and it's a really important answer, and it has a lot to do with this paradigm shift that sometimes needs to be made. If what you want is a horse that works hard and performs for you and does your bidding, there are certain obligations on your part that go with that. And so we're going to talk about that. So today's lesson is actually relationship training part two. And the question of the day is, does your horse accept your authority? In other words, does your horse accept your leadership? So these are really big questions, and sort of the answer to all of the above. So very shortly, I'm going to get to that lesson. as people are coming on board, let's see, we're up in the 60s now. Like to see that number go up to the hundreds. So share with your friends, hit like, do all that magic stuff that makes Facebook pay attention. And I want to share with you some late breaking news that has to do with something I've been talking about since this shutdown began, which is that horses are going to be at even greater risk now with the economy in this dangerous territory we're in with the economy. That translates to many significantly more horses being at risk of being lost in the system, of being neglected, of in some cases starvation because people can't afford to feed them anymore, or in many, many cases, in the case of hundreds of thousands of horses headed over the border in trucks bound for slaughter. And so this late breaking news is something that happened yesterday here in my part of the country. And it does not directly have to do with the COVID-19 situation, but it does. And we need your help. And here is the reason why. So this morning, bright and early, I get a call from my dear friend Sharon Gilbert at the Colorado Horse Rescue. That's a well-established, very active horse rescue up in Longmont, Colorado, I've been involved with for a long time. And Sharon is one of the directors there. I believe she is the director of adoption. And so Sharon called me this morning to alert me to what was going on in case there was some way that I could pitch in and help. And without a doubt, there is. So basically what happened is, or what I know of the story via Sharon, is that a year or two ago, an outfitter up in Nebraska went out of business, and he had a large-ish herd of horses. Really, technically, we wouldn't call this a herd of horses. You would call it a remuda. And that is a large group of saddle horses, which is what outfitters have. So it was a dude ranch outfitter, went out of business. This herd of 68 horses has been left untended and to fend for themselves for a year or more. So they have been neglected in terms of health maintenance. It didn't appear to me that there was a starvation issue going on, but there was, these horses needed attention, they needed care, and they needed to be taken out of this situation and put into adoptive homes. And so, let's see, there was a rescue, a couple of rescues here in Colorado. Actually, five rescues ultimately were involved. One rescue went up there to assess, this was a voluntary surrender of horses, so this was not a law enforcement seizure. The horses were in Nebraska, just over the state line from Colorado. Colorado has a very well-established network of large functional horse rescues. So the Colorado Rescue was engaged. They went up there and checked out the situation. While they were there, or right when they got there, the herd of 68 horses had broken down a rotten old fence and were, you know, out on the highway and had to be rounded up. And it was determined to be a dire situation for these horses. There are horses that needed medical attention. They certainly all needed health maintenance, and they certainly all need a future that doesn't involve a slaughter truck. And so this rescue immediately recognized the gravity of the situation, and they employed the assistance of four other rescues. So the five rescues were Safe Landing in South Denver. I believe they're the ones that initiated the thing. Carolyn Horse Rescue in Elizabeth, Colorado. Drifters Hearts of Hope. I believe it was Drifters Hearts of Hope that initiated the contact with these people for a voluntary surrender of these horses. And then they got Harmony Equine Center and the Colorado Horse Rescue involved, which was important. And this is important for a number of reasons. First of all, Sharon was so thrilled that all of these horse rescues mobilized, came together, they put together a caravan, and they went up and they picked up 58 horses all in one caravan yesterday, and they brought them back here to Colorado. They dispersed the horses between the five rescues. They looked at the assets and the resources of each one of those rescues, and they put the numbers of horses and the types of horses with the rescues that had the most resources. So Harmony Equine Center is a large, primarily law enforcement impound center, strictly designed and built and managed for equine. And it is in Franktown, Colorado. And I've done some filming there. And the guy that runs the place, Garrett Leonard, is a friend of mine. And they do unbelievable work there. And they're highly funded, they're entirely funded by the Denver Dumb Friends League. So this is a highly funded, dedicated facility to equine welfare. And they move a lot of horses through this operation that need help. So between Harmony and Colorado Horse Rescue and Drifters Hearts of Hope and Safe Landing Horse Rescue and Tara Lynn Horse Rescue, all of these horses are now in a rescue. They're being evaluated. They are being vetted. They are being vaccinated. By the way, they had to, up there, they were faced with 68 horses. The 10 of them stayed up there. 58 were brought to Colorado. They had to identify every single one of these horses, find a Coggins test or get a Coggins test on every single one of those horses, and then get them sorted according to where they needed to go. And I guess they just did all that in a couple of days. And boom, the horses arrived in Colorado yesterday. So how does this relate to today, and how does this relate to you? You may not be anywhere near Colorado, and you may not be able to help these horses. These are 58 riding horses that, through no fault of their own, after working hard and being of service to many, many, many riders, taking them on trail rides, up in the mountains, in the foothills, whatever, they suddenly found themselves in this dire situation. And so some of these horses will be too old to become great riding horses, but they would be awesome companion horses or babysitting horses for, you know, the few years they have left. By the way, the horses ranged in age. None of them were super young. So of the 11 horses the Colorado Horse Rescue took, the youngest was 11 years old, and the old 25-year-old isn't going to be around for a huge amount of time more. But he would probably be a great babysitter horse or a great companion. And so these horses range in age. They range in condition. Some certainly have arthritic conditions and are going to need help. But some of them are going to be great riding horses that will find wonderful homes. But right now, because of COVID, adoptions have essentially stopped because, here in Colorado, at least, with stay-at-home orders, the Colorado Horse Rescue, they went from having 100 volunteers that helped take care of these horses to 10 to be able to, be compliant with the guidelines set forth by our governor. And so that includes some of their management staff as well, and that certainly means that potential adopters can't come out ranch and visit all the horses and ride all the horses and all that. So adoptions have temporarily been put on hold. And all of these rescues have a certain amount of capacity they can take. Colorado Horse Rescue was already close to or above their capacity before taking these horses. All of the horses they currently have on their facility have already been cleared for adoption from a family who's ready for them, but that adoption can't be completed until the stay-at-home orders are over. So we have a temporary backlog of horses and nowhere to put them. And this, my friends, the reason why it's important that you know about this is because this is happening all over the country. And there are horse rescues in your area that are taking in horses in need, and they need help. They need your help. And certainly we know they need money. And if you should be so fortunate as to have extra money right now, any rescue, established rescue in your area could use your funds. You can go to therighthorse.org and find partners in your area. But a lot of us can't contribute money, especially right now when you're out of work or things are getting risky in the financial department. So there's a lot you can do. If you're a horse owner, if you're an experienced horse owner and you have one empty stall or one empty pen, you could take one horse on a temporary foster situation. The need for foster homes for horses at risk that are being brought into the adoption pipeline is great. You don't have to take a horse forever, but you could be instrumental in getting that horse into the adoption pipeline, just like you see with these horses, these 58 horses that came down from Nebraska to Colorado yesterday. So these horses need a place to stay for 30 days or 60 days, maybe 90 days, while they work through the evaluation of the horse, getting the horse up to date on his vaccines and worming and health maintenance, his teeth loaded, evaluating the horse's training, getting him the training he needs to make him an adoptable, safe, and purposeful horse. And you could help with that. If you're an experienced horse person, now we do not need people that are inexperienced horse owners. We need you to have the experience to take care of horses. And if you should also happen to have a little bit of training ability, in other words, you've had some experience doing ground manners, you've had some experience working with maybe Mustangs or rescue horses or whatever, horses that missed training, you could be instrumental. And just imagine if you took one of these dude horses and it was a 12-year-old gelding that had been a trail horse for the last 5-6 years, and you found him to be an incredible horse with excellent manners and great training out on the trail, and anyone could ride him. And imagine the future that that horse is going to have when we find the right forever home for him. So you can be instrumental in this way as a foster person. Hey, maybe you can't take a horse. There's another way you might be able to help. They're having a lot of trouble transporting these horses to and from a foster home. Maybe there's a foster home over here that could take one or two horses, but they don't have any way to transport them. The rescue's too busy to transport. Well, hello, everyone. Did you ever have that experience where you're talking on the phone and you're telling a big long story and you wonder why no one's responding, and then you find out you've been talking for 15 minutes and you've been disconnected all that time? Yeah, that's me right now. So thanks for coming back on board with me. And I was going on a leap of faith that my life feed was still working because the ticker was ticking, and finally Megan called me and said, you know, nobody's listening to you because they can't hear you. So I don't know where I got cut off. I do know I was very far into a very serious rant and about taking care of horses that are in need, taking care of horses that are at risk of homelessness, at risk of neglect, at risk of coming into the slaughter pipeline rather than into the adoption pipeline, and our obligation to help. And I was talking about, and Suze, maybe you can let me know where I was when I got cut off, because I hate to go into the whole rant again if you already heard it. Okay, so I was talking about how they transported those horses. They got them to Colorado. And so now there are 58 horses. These horses got dispersed to the appropriate facilities, five different well-established horse rescues in the state of Colorado have split these horses up. The next thing that'll happen is they'll be evaluated for health maintenance. They'll get caught up to date on vaccines, deworming, farrier. They're in terrible need of farrier help. So there will be many, many people that come into play to help these horses along the pipeline. Now, this situation of these 58 horses has nothing to do. No, I think it was my bad internet. Sorry. But from Mexico, hola. This situation has nothing to do with COVID. These horses have been at risk and have been neglected for over a year. What brings this situation relevant to COVID and relevant to today is that we know, and I've already talked about this already on many of my live posts, we know with the economy diving and with people being out of work and businesses closing, we know that more horses will be at risk. And we know that more horses are going to end up in the slaughter pipeline if we don't intervene. So how can you help? You know, not all of us have money to contribute. I get that. If you do have money, you can go to myridehorse.org and you can find a local or regional shelter or rescue or sanctuary in your area that's well established, not an individual, but a nonprofit organization, and you can that has been in partnership with the ASPCA and the Right Horse Initiative, and they will help you find a place to direct your money. But look, a lot of us don't have money, especially now, to contribute. But there's a lot you can do. The Right Horse, myrighthorse.org, is launching a brand new campaign to make people understand that there is a huge need for fostering horses that are coming into the rescue pipeline. And so most of these facilities are already operating at full capacity. And so when a large seizure or voluntary surrender, like these 58 horses, occurs, where do these horses go? All the rescues are already at capacity. Also, the reason why COVID relates is adoptions, current adoptions already in the process have been stopped. They're on hold. They will happen soon. But in the meanwhile, horses that have already been approved for adoption in this home aren't able to leave there until the restrictions are relieved. And so we need, for instance, some of these horses that are just, they've already been approved for adoption, but it's going to be a few weeks or a month before their new home can get situated in their new home. That horse could use your empty stall for 4 weeks. So the foster need is huge. We need people to take horses, experienced horse owners, that have an empty stall or an empty pen that they can take one or two horses, experience in taking care of horses. So you know how to feed them, take care of them. If you have training and handling skills, you're needed as a foster trainer. If you're an experienced horse person that's worked with young horses or untrained horses or abused horses or whatever, you could be a foster trainer. You could take these horses that need evaluation, look, some of these horses, probably all of these horses coming out of this Nebraska situation were dude horses. They're experienced trail horses. They're saddle horses. So we need knowledgeable, experienced people with an empty place in their barn to help either just simply care for these horses as they transition through the process, or even better, to help with the evaluation and training and evaluation of these horses so they can get more quickly into the pipeline. So thanks for putting those posts up there, you guys. And I'm so sorry about the connection, the video. We all know how difficult that is these days, especially those of us that live in rural settings. But so I want to make one more announcement, and then I'll jump into our lesson. But I want to make one more announcement just because I think it's timely right now. It's a little sooner than I had planned to announce this because this has all just occurred over the last couple of days. But I have decided, after being poked and prodded by my friend Christy, who's the program director at the Right Horse Initiative, I have decided to put my money where my mouth is. I'm going to take a special needs horse in foster training. This is a 3-year-old gelding that is deaf and has had little to no handling and is needs a lot of help before he's ready to go into the adoption pipeline. So I believe it takes a village to help a horse. So my crew is going to help. My friends are going to help. We're going to get this little horse trained, and we are going to get him to be the best little horse anyone ever wanted to adopt. And then we were going to get him to his forever home, we hope, in the coming months. We are going to try to record that entire journey for this little guy, and edit it into a social media campaign so you can take part in it as well. But I want you to start thinking about how you can help. Go to myrighthorse.org if you can help a rescue. Look, maybe you don't have a place to foster a horse. Maybe you're not in a position to adopt a horse. Maybe you can't contribute money. But maybe you have a horse trailer and a truck, and you could help with the transportation needs. The transportation needs between the rescue and the adoption home, between the rescue and the foster home, between the foster home and the adoption home. The need for transportation is great. Maybe you have an extra 20, 30, 50 bales of hay you overpurchased last year. These horses need to eat, and a lot of these rescues may be grateful to get a donation of hay, halters, lead ropes, whatever, saddles, tack, if we're trying to repurpose these horses as riding horses. So the need is great. The way you can help is there are many, and so I want you to think about it more. I will be too as I jump into this foster training endeavor. I'll try to get some photographs. I don't know if Twyla or Megan can maybe post some photographs up on Facebook of our little gunner colt that we're gonna take. He I don't know if he has a name yet, but I would say I'll probably be calling him Baldy, and you'll see why. Okay, I said yes, deaf, not dead. I would not take really a dead horse for training. So DEAF. This horse is I don't know that much about his breeding and all that. He appears to be a paint horse to me, but he is related to the reigning horse sire called Gunner, who had many deaf offspring. So that's an unfortunate tragedy of doing a poor job of selective breeding. But it's not this guy's fault, right? And look, there are a lot of deaf horses, not a lot, but there are definitely deaf horses out there. I think there's deaf in every species. And so it's no big deal. I train horses for hand signals anyway. We just learn to work around it. Okay, so I'm just gonna go take a look at your for hire comments real fast. Carmelie, good to hear from you. All right, I'm not seeing the comments on my phone, and maybe you're not making them, and so you're probably going, okay, enough about the preaching, Julie. Time to get on to the daily dose of horsemanship homework. So, as I started in my previous attempt at the Facebook Live, as I said, today's daily dose of horsemanship homework is a living room lesson, obviously. And I believe that I need to go one step further in the conversation that we had yesterday regarding relationships between horses, regarding the fact that horses are very relationship-oriented animals, about what that looks like in the herd. And okay, so I'm going to try to read the comments as they go by. Hi, Betsy Bradley. And I'm in Georgia, but I'm sure there are rescues in my area. Absolutely. I have too much grass. In fact, too much grass. You need one of those starvation cases. You know, and the starvation cases happen for different reasons at different times. And sometimes it's related to drought and hay prices. And sometimes people just lose their jobs or get a divorce or have to move. And horses just end up in these horrible situations that nobody intended. It's not necessarily bad people doing bad things. It's just bad situations that have evolved in most cases. So, I'm missing some good comments, I'm afraid. Okay, Beth, when should I use sport boots? Oh, that's a good question. Actually, how to put them on is a huge pet peeve of mine. Because so many people kind of find my topics list. I love that one. Sports boots. And I'm gonna have to defer that until I'm, in my tack room and can show you different boots and how to put them on. But I love that for a topic. Just different types of boots and why we use them, but most importantly, how to put them on correctly, because I've seen the craziest things you wouldn't believe with boots in clinics. I remember one time there was a guy in my clinic and he had shipping boots on his horse. He'd come into the arena to ride, saddled and bridled and everything, with shipping boots on. And it was kind of weird, and so I didn't want him to be embarrassed, so I just privately said to him, those are shipping boots, they're not really for riding. And he got, I guess, embarrassed, so he got mad and kind of huffed out. But then when he came back, the horse had some rope burns on his legs. I shouldn't laugh, but and the guy was actually trying to hide those. So anyway. So we can talk about sports medicine boots and why you use them, how you use them, and not just sports medicine boots, but all different kinds of boots. There's a lot of different things out there, and particularly, and then you go to after riding and poultice and standing wraps and those kind of things. We could do a whole day on that. Never use them, but I'll be riding in an arena where the footing is questionable. It's not the sports medicine boot. No. Protective boots are going to do nothing to help you for bad footing. Bad footing is bad for the horse, no matter what kind of protective gear you put on him. So you can't really mitigate that through boots. And so let's see. I'm going to finish the question. In an area where footing is questionable, should I use sports boots? No, I'm going to ride. You have to adjust your riding to footing that is questionable. So if the footing is not safe for the horse, you just don't do what you were going to do. If it's not safe for jumping, you don't jump. If it's not safe for reining, you don't rein. If I ride an arena that's not a suitable surface for a horse that's trained to slide stop to stop that way, I will not cue him to stop that way in that footing. And if he's a seasoned horse, he won't stop in that footing anyway. So then I run into a training problem if I cue him and he says, no, I'm not doing that. So what mitigates good footing or bad footing is grooming it or waiting to do the more arduous activities like cantering, circling, maneuvers, collection, really a lot of hard trotting or cantering. Most horses can walk around just fine in bad footing. But the sports medicine boots or protective boots to be used when you ride are to protect the horse from himself. And so if he trips and, you know, clips a foot with another foot, if he overreaches, if he, you know, interferes with himself, either front foot to front foot or from a hind foot to a front foot. We like sports medicine boots. We like the idea that they actually prevent orthopedic injury, but they don't. They just don't. They're not that significant of an amount of support. So we use them more often for a protective covering that is athletic and supportive and moves with the horse. And if he should interfere with his feet, protects his legs from injury. So some horses they would use bell boots on because they're big movers. They tend to overstep a little bit from behind. And if that horse is maybe doing a spin and he's pivoting really fast with his front feet, or doing a 180 or rollback or something like that, sometimes they, you know, step on themselves, and so it's a protective situation. The sports medicine part of it's kind of a marketing ploy. Okay. Our local rescue takes old tack and sells it in online auctions for fun. That's awesome. So see, I've cleaned out my tack room so many times for horse rescues. It's funny because then sometimes, and I donate a lot of stuff to CSU Equine too, so sometimes I go up there and I'm like, oh, I recognize that. Let's see. Praise for you and your staff. Thank you. Okay. Vaccines. How about your thoughts on vaccines and deporting? Oh, I wonder if that's a typo. So vaccines, you know, that's important information for you to know, but it's not one I can really do in this format because, first of all, the vaccines that your horse is given should be dictated by your veterinarian, and I'm not a vet. And second of all, it's very highly regional. And so the vaccines that are recommended here in Colorado won't be the same as the vaccines that are recommended in Florida or New York or California. So you really have, that's a local, regional situation. I will tell you this, I believe very strongly that you should have a relationship with a vet that treats horses, and that you should have that horse come out once a year. We do it in the spring, and do a wellness exam on your horse and give him his vaccines. Let the vet give the vaccines. He knows what vaccines to use. He has the freshest, best vaccines. He will take, or she will take, responsibility for the administering of that vaccine and any reaction that the horse might subsequently have. And furthermore, and most importantly, when I call that vet up at midnight on a Sunday night because I need help with a colicking horse, I think that vet deserves to have a relationship with the horse that I'm calling about. And that's where the relationship begins, is with that wellness exam and to become a patient of that veterinarian. So, that's the way I address vaccines. So maybe I've already covered that topic now. Okay, I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to come back. This is another great lesson from Dove, or another great question from Dove that I'm going to come back to. I want to just get through today's lesson quickly. This has already gone on way longer than I had planned because of the technical problems. But I just wanted, you know, to review what we talked about yesterday. We talked about the relationship dynamics that exist between horses within a herd of horses. We also talked about how that then carries over to your relationship with your horse, because he only knows how to act like a horse. He does not know how to act any other way. And so he brings what he understands in terms of relationship between horses to his relationship with you. And so the missing part of that equation is that you learn to understand that relationship dynamic. And so in this regard, you can think of you and your horse as a herd of two. We talked about the hierarchy in a horse herd being linear. meaning it's a linear hierarchy. That's what we refer to as the pecking order. So in any group of horses, there's a linear hierarchy of leadership, where there's a horse at the top called the alpha, and then there's the next horse in line called the beta, and then there's the next horse, the next horse, the next horse. So you get to the very last horse, it's on the very bottom of the totem pole, and that horse is called the omega. And so in theory, the hierarchy in a horse herd is linear. Each and every individual is either dominant over or subordinate to each and every other individual. So in your herd of two, one of you is dominant and one of you is subordinate. There's no question about this in the horse's mind. You make that abundantly clear to the horse in every second of interaction that you have with him. You make it abundantly clear that you either are the one in charge or you are not. You either are the leader or you are not. You cannot fake leadership to horses. They know it. They know it better than people, I would argue, demonstratively. So either you step up to the plate and act appropriately as the leader, or the horse steps up to the place. When the horse gets to be the leader, when the horse makes all the rules, and he makes them to his advantage, and that generally does not involve working for you. So also yesterday we talked most importantly about, what does the horse get from the herd that makes him so drawn to the herd? And the answer is simple. It is safety and comfort. A sense of security and safety and creature comfort. Comfort includes companionship, laying and standing in the shade, swishing each other's flies, grooming each other, laying down in the softest ground, eating the best delectable green grass, whatever. Having companionship, having leadership. So what gives horses a sense of security once they've been accepted into a herd is that there is leadership, there is hierarchy, that they don't have to think and make decisions. Someone else is making all those decisions for them. That alpha individual in the herd has a huge responsibility. She's responsible for motivating the herd to flight, should flight be necessary, which means she has to monitor the environment for danger to know when it's appropriate to motivate for flight. She has to lead the herd to food and water, so they keep an organized, orderly schedule. Sometimes they travel miles and miles for food and water. And then she has to maintain order and discipline in the herd. So if there is an unruly herd mate, if this horse is picking on that horse, if there's a mare about to foal, or a horse is chasing a baby, whatever, she's going to step in there and mete out the discipline. So she creates the rules and she enforces the rules, and she is the most highly regarded individual in the herd. So it's hard for people coming new into horses to get this, but what gives horses a sense of safety and security is when there is structure, rules, order, routine, consistency, fairness. And by consistency, I mean the same expectations every day. You break the rule, you get the same answer. You abide by the rule, you get the same reward. So they love sameness, they love routine, they love order. They thrive under this. Horses, the more uncertain a horse is, the more a horse lacks confidence, the safer he feels when someone else is making the decisions. So when you take over leadership with that horse and he doesn't have to worry, where's the next thing that's gonna scare me? What do I do next? What's the right answer to this problem? He doesn't have to worry like that when he gives himself over to a strong, confident leader. He just has to go along for the ride. And a lot of horses, if not most horses, just love that. And so What they're looking for in a strong leader is an individual that makes really good decisions and that the decisions always benefit the herd. And so when we think of our herd of two, and I am now the leader of my horse, the decisions I make on a regular basis as I interact with him are either good for him or bad for him. And I'm not talking about he's lazy and now he has to work, so that's bad. I'm talking about if I ask him to do something that actually causes him pain. What if I make a mistake and I accidentally jerk him in the mouth when he was going that way and I jerk this way? What if I lose my balance and slam down on his back? What if I ask him to get in the horse trailer and he gets scared and throws his head up and busts his head open? What if I ask him to do something that results in such a traumatic incident that he fears for his life? If any of those things happen, I have fallen down on my job as a leader. So if I expect this horse to work for me, if I expect this horse to try and please me, if I expect this horse to do my bidding, to let me ride him, carry me, go as long as I want, go out on the trail ride by himself, do that fancy horse show maneuver, whatever. If I expect my horse to do that for him, I have to take responsibility for all of the decisions that are made, including the bad decisions that I make. So when I talked yesterday about owning your mistakes, and this is a big part of that. So if I make a bad decision, let's say I'm riding a great trail horse out by himself, and I come across, maybe I got tired of being on the trail, so I did a very bad thing and I went off the trail and I'm bushwhacking it. It's a bad thing for the environment. I don't do that. But let's say you did. And then you came to the creek and you had to cross it, but there was no good crossing. There was no good ford. First thing you should say to yourself is, should have stayed on the trail. The trail would have led you to a good crossing. So, but if instead you try to cross that creek in an unsafe place and the horse knows it's unsafe, so he resists. Now you've turned an obedient horse into a disobedient horse. And so you get in a big fight with him and you push him over the creek. And because he is at root an obedient horse, after you fight with him a little bit and go through that traumatic experience and push him into the creek, he gets hurt climbing out of that creek and pulls a whatever, strains a tendon. And now you're going to ride him all the way back with an injury because you didn't notice the injury. So all of that showed again and again to the horse that you're a poor leader, you make poor decisions, you do not have his best interest in mind, you cannot be trusted. So when people talk about establishing trust with horses, that's not just about releasing at the right time, and it's not just about, you know, having good hands or whatever, or giving the correct cue. It's not just about, you know, giving fair correction to the horse when he acts poorly. It's about not making stupid decisions that result in a big fight, a big traumatic experience, or a horse getting injured. Sometimes these things happen even though we don't intend them to, and you have to work through. But I want you to just start thinking about how much, if your horse trusts you to be the leader, if your horse has given himself to you and accepts your authority, you have an obligation to make good decisions. You have an obligation to own your own mistakes and make as few of them as possible. And you have the important obligation to keep your horse safe at all times, both emotionally and physically. So that is my lesson to continue relationship training. And because I cut that a little bit short because we got a big delay today and you guys have a lot of questions. I'm going to try to scroll through them now. But I had a few more things I want to cover, which stuff I've talked about before, but I would like to make a purposeful lesson out of it. So I'm going to save it for my next living room lesson. So By the way, this will be my last live post for a few days. I'll come back at you live, I don't know, early next week, Monday or Tuesday. However, I'm going to do some arena lessons for a few days, and so we get some outside activity for you guys. So I will keep you posted on the subsequent Facebook Lives. For now, what I would like to do is go through the comments and answer your question. And I'm going to start, Susie, with your question from yesterday, which was something along the lines of, how do I know when my horse is asking for my help, or what do I do when he's asking for my help? And although I'm not sure what that question meant, I will tell you this. Particularly when I'm doing groundwork with people and their horses in clinics, so I've got maybe 10 or 15 horses and their owners, and they're doing, you know, various stages of groundwork. And I often tell people, first of all, I often see horses looking to the person for what in the heck am I supposed to do right now? And the person just becomes, just freezes up and is devoid of information at that point. So there are many times when you're working with a horse, particularly from the ground, where he will just stop and turn and look at you with his head up and his ears on you, and a look on his face like, what the heck? And that is a horse that's saying, I need some input here because I have no idea what I'm supposed to be doing. And that is a horse that is looking to you for a directive. He's asking you, what should I be doing for you? And when you don't recognize that plea for help from your horse, and you scold him in that moment, or you give him some confusing command, or maybe worse, you do nothing, you just sort of go catatonic, the horse is discouraged. He's discouraged for asking for help. He's discouraged from trying because he's looking at you going, I need some help here. What do I do? So in that moment, that horse turns and looks at me with a puzzle on his face. First of all, I'm grateful that he's asking my input. So I acknowledge that in my voice. Good boy. And then I say, so I'll talk to horses. A lot of times when I'm working with horses, I'm mic'd up anyway. So I talk to the horse so that the people watching can understand what I'm communicating. But I don't think it hurts for you to talk to the horse at when you're apologizing for screwing something up, or when you're trying to be more definitive on what you're asking the horse to do. Explain it with your words, because that will help you use your body language better, which will help the horse understand better. And make sure the tone of voice is conducive to what how you need the horse to respond. So when you get that blank look from the horse, like, what am I supposed to do? If I were working on the ground, I would say, I would kind of just take that as a cue to slow myself down and be ultra clear. So I'd say, good boy, I need you to go that way. Good boy. And I might slowly pick up my flag or my stick over or rope over here and say, come on. Good. Yeah, that's right. Good boy. Yeah, you got it. Good boy. You know, so help them. When the horse is looking to you for direction, give them direction. The second question from yesterday was, how does a horse go forward without resistance? How do you get a horse to go forward without resistance? It's a very, very simple thing. Very simple thing for a horse trainer to do. But right now there is an epidemic of horses without work ethics. And so a horse trainer who starts young horses, and we've known this for thousands of years, by the way. If you go back and read books on horsemanship that are thousands of years old, they will say, as we say in classical horsemanship, that the number one most fundamental basis of training horses is that forward motion is the basis of all training. Without free and willing forward motion, the horse cannot be trained. If you have a horse that you have inadvertently trained not to go forward, that horse is missing one of the most fundamental basis of training. And that is, you have to go forward when I ask, and you have to stay forward for as long as I ask until I ask you something different. And that is what I refer to as a work ethic in a horse. When I ask you to go forward, you have to not only go forward with a yes ma'am attitude, but you are responsible for maintaining that gait until I ask you to stop. It's not my job to tell you to keep going time and time and time again. That's your job. If you don't do your job, you will hear about it from me. But this is literally the very first thing a horse has to learn in his training, to go forward and to move until I ask you to stop. We started on the ground. So when you have that fundamental of a disobedience problem in the horse, it definitely has, it's going to carry into everything you do with this horse. He's going to question authority. He's going to argue. He's going to at some point refuse. It wouldn't take a trainer 5 minutes to sort that out. You have given cues and not reinforced them. That's all that's happened there. So he believes responding to the cue is optional, and he believes that the longer he stalls after you cue him, the more benefit he gets. So you have trained him to be non-responsive. So we would retrain that horse through reinforcement. I am training for the lightest possible cue. So it was a trained horse I was talking about that had become resistant over time to moving forward. I would use a simple little crop, and I would hold the crop in one hand, and with the end of it pointing down right about where my legs contact the horse when I ask him to go. I would put both hands in one rein. I would reach forward and shift my weight forward, softly close both legs with the lightest possible go cue. I would give the horse about a half a second to respond, and then I would reinforce by spanking him with the crop right where my leg closed on him. The reinforcement would come fast, and it would be just the right amount of pressure to take away the benefit from that horse of not responding to me. Understand, it's not that he didn't hear the cue, feel the cue, or know what the cue was. He can feel a fly land on his skin. It was that he willfully disobeyed the cue. He willfully ignored the cue. So I would correct that horse literally within a couple of minutes, and he would move off the light cue. So you have a different relationship with this horse, and this is something that has developed over time. So it's going to be harder because that dynamic had already exists for you where it wouldn't have existed for me. In other words, the horse wouldn't have had a preconceived notion about me. He would have resisted the forward movement when I gave him the light cue because that's his habitual behavior. But with the appropriate amount of reinforcement in the appropriate timing, he would instantly go, oops, can't get away with that with her. I'm going to go back to responding to a light cue. So that's the answer to that question. Now, starting with Dove, nose bands. Why is it so common, especially English, to strap a mouth shut? I love you, Dove. I would think it would make the horse uncomfortable. Why? Yes, it does. And if they don't keep the bit well, doesn't that mean they need a new bit? Yes. Doesn't that mean the bit or the handling of the bit is not right? Okay. All of that is accurate. So, first of all, nosebands, cavassons are traditional training, pieces of training equipment that go back, you know, thousands of years. Some of them are more torture devices than others. So just a simple nose band around the nose of the horse, not tight, a simple cavesson on an English bridle, appropriately adjusted, puts no pressure on the horse's nose and does not interfere with his breathing at all. But when you use a drop noseband, a figure eight noseband, or you strap the horse's mouth shut below the bits, and he can no longer open his mouth, in some instances he cannot even swallow because his mouth is trapped so shut, and you know that because of the drool that's coming out of his mouth. But all of the nosebands that go down below the bits cut across the nostril of the horse, which interferes with the dilation of the nostril when the horse is at full aerobic capacity or max VO2. Those nostrils get huge, and that strap across the nostril most certainly interferes with the breathing of the horse. And in some guesstimates, up to 20 or 30% at full max VO2. Also, having the mouth strapped shut is in no way comfortable for the horse. But the worst thing of it is a lot of people do it for no good reason, because I ask people all the time when they come into my clinics with the mouth strapped shut, why they are doing it, or the head tied down. Why are you doing that? Because if it's a Band-Aid covering up a festering wound, less clean and disinfect that wound, less find the solution to the horse's problem. If you're strapping the mouth shut because the horse is gaping his mouth open, which is highly penalized in horse shows, in some cases it's elimination. If the horse is gaping his mouth shut, the solution is not strap it shut. The solution is figure out a bit he can tolerate. And that's what I say in the Myler 33 is a bit that often eliminates all kinds of gaping problems, all kinds of sticking the tongue out the mouth problems. But the worst to me is when people are strapping a mouth shut on a horse or tying their head down just because everybody else does it and their horse doesn't even need that. I don't think any horses, now I will say that the traditional tie down, for instance, used on a team roping horse, that serves a purpose and it helps a horse do his job. It's adjusted correctly. It's a big, wide, padded noseband attached to a big, wide, padded breast collar so that horse can lean into the dally. That is equipment that supports the athletic endeavor of that horse. But if you're tying that head down because the horse throws his head, let's talk about why your horse is throwing his head. And it's either because he cannot tolerate the hands of the rider, he's got a bit in his mouth he can't tolerate, or both. Or there's a lack of training there. So, yes to all of your questions. I don't know. Now, we use cavessons in the training of a Western horse. When you get into advanced stages of training and you're doing a lot of high-level jumping, high-level dressage, high-level reining or cow horse stuff, and you are working on really high-level maneuvers, and we're doing a lot of collection, we're doing a lot of difficult maneuvers, look, we use bit contact, and sometimes a lot of it, in the process of training the horse to perform these things. So, that is why often we see more cavessons used in higher level training, but we can use them to support the horse's training, or we can use them in a way that's not so supportive of the welfare of the horse too. So what's most important about artificial aids is that you know how to use, you know why you're using it first, you know how to use it correctly, how to adjust it, what its purpose is, because a lot of people, you know, like a lot of people think the running martingale is to lower the headset of the horse, and it has nothing to do with that. It's to prevent the horse's head from getting dangerously high, so high that you lose control of the horse. So a properly adjusted running martingale never interferes with the horse in the normal task of his job. It's not to lower the head. So know why you're using it, how to use it correctly, how to adjust it correctly, and most importantly, how can we develop a plan to get away from using that artificial aid? So that's kind of my, and by all means, there's so much we can do to make bits more comfortable for horses. There's so much more out there now. You know, Milers have spent decades refining and engineering and redesigning bits to make them better for horses.
So if you go to my website, I'm sure somebody will put up a link. You can read more about that. You can fill out a bidding questionnaire and actually find the best bit for your horse. A lot of bit resistance just comes from the inappropriate bit. But you are so right, Dove, that the harshest bit in the world in soft hands isn't going to be a problem for the horse. The mildest bit in the world in terrible hands is bad for the horse. Okay, moving on down now, Susie. Overreach boots make excellent toys to taunt your handler with. Oh yeah, that's Pepperoni's theory on bell boots. It's just one more thing to destroy, and no matter how you tie him up, if you leave those bell boots on him, he will figure out a way to rip them off. I don't know how many sets of bell boots he has gone through, including the gator boots that they said were indestructible. So, perfect for moving with your teeth. Bonus if you swing them in a circle as you run around the round pin. Your pony is a character, Susie. Okay, let's see. Deworming. Just, I don't have, again, a lot to say on that subject, except I will to tell you how I do it. We do fecal egg tests twice a year. If all of my horses come back clean, I might not even do it twice. But you know, if out of seven horses, sometimes all of them will come back clean because we keep a pretty clean environment for our horses, and that means deworming is not needed. But some, maybe two or three of the horses will come back with a little bit of strongyle or a little bit of this. It'll show in the fecal egg count. And so then we deworm those horses. So then we retest those horses again in the fall to make sure they're not reinfected, or to make sure we got them clean. And so I mean, I've come a long way in the deworming. There was a time when we dewormed horses every month. Of course, I would go back to the original when your vet would come out twice a year and deworm the horse with a tube down into his stomach. And so then we went to the paste dewormers, and they got really great. And so it eliminated tube deworming, which was awful for horses. And so at one time, we went all the way up to deworming once a month to really keep those horses fit and shiny. And really free of worms. And then we realized we were overdoing it, so we went to quarterly deworming. And then when it became common knowledge that the fecal egg count, that you didn't always have to deworm, and that it was better all the way around if we only deworm the horses that need it when they need it, and specific to the parasites, that's just better horse husbandry. And a good way to save money. The fecal egg counts aren't free, but they're less expensive than dewormer. And so if all of my horses come back clean and I don't have to buy any dewormer, I'm way ahead of the game. I put less toxicity into that horse. And, you know, I believe there's an environmental impact as well. I don't know if that's true or not, but the more toxins we can avoid in the environment, in our horse environment, and therefore the larger environment, I believe that's better. So that's what I do. And then we generally will use ivermectin if we want to deworm that horse. But ever so often, meaning every two or three years, sometimes we give horses what's called a power pack, which is, the name of the dewormer is escaping me right at the moment, but it's a sort of a P, I think. It's a power pack. You get five doses, and you give it 5 days in a row, and it really is like a major deworming. If you maybe just got a new horse that had questionable care, or maybe a horse that had been unthrifty for some time, meaning you can't get weight on him, he doesn't look very good, his hair coat's rough, he's not responding to the typical ivermectin. Sometimes we want to do a power pack on those horses to really purge their systems of all the possible parasites that could be in there. So that's my take on it. All right, I'd like to learn to post. I did not have access to a trainer in arena. Okay, I'm going to write that down as a good arena lesson. Now, my friend Susie, who's on this post, suggested that I do a living room lesson on posting using my big exercise ball. And here is my answer to that suggestion, Susie. Are you kidding me? You want me to go on the internet live, sitting on a giant exercise ball and gyrating hip movements to teach people to post? Are you kidding me? I'm not doing that. I will, however, show you how to do it on a horse. So I'm going to save that for a living room lesson. So thanks for that suggestion, Vicki. Sometime I'd love to hear about how you deal with horses that are hard and impossible to catch in the field without resorting to food bribery. Okay, here's a little pitch for my online training resources. So I have been in this business for 30 years of training horses, and I have been producing media for all of that time. And so between written articles, between recorded audio podcasts, and between the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of videos I have done, all of that resource material from 3 decades of my career is on my website. And it is, a lot of it's accessible through a free membership. A lot of it is only accessible through a paid subscription, but it doesn't cost much. And all of it is searchable content by keywords. If you were to, and you can actually do this on the free side of my website, and maybe Diana can even bring up this article. Just search hard to catch. And resolving a horse of that behavior is not hard to do. But you have to understand what you're doing and understand the technique. And so my technique for retraining a horse that's hard to catch is to do what I call walk him off. And I'm not going to take the time to explain it there because that information is posted on the free side of my website. On the paid side of my website, there are numerous, literally numerous videos that relate to that. Probably some audio recordings as well as many other articles. So I'd encourage you to check that out. I just had one of, I think it might have, well, some of my interactive members have had that challenge. But the great thing about the technique that I share with you on the hard to catch horse is, honest to God, it works 100% of the time. If you read the article and understand the concept, you can't screw this up. And I've never had anyone say they didn't get a response from this horse and using this technique of walking them off. Have to have patience. You might need some comfortable walking shoes, but you'll get the job done. So, posting trot information. Lisa Gunther from Florida. Hello, my friend. I'm very aware that I've created the disrespectful relationship my horse has with me. He sees me as a herd mate, not the lead mare. Julie, you have personally observed this with Metro and me. Absolutely. And is it too late to change the dynamic? If not, how do I start? I know Lisa and her horse well. I've had her in several clinics of, I don't know how many years, we've known each other now. And I go to Florida a lot, so I've seen her through the years. She's traveled long distances to come to my clinics with her fabulous horse, Metro, who's a Pasifino, stunningly handsome Pasifino. He's a very strong, dominant horse, as many of them are. Those horses are bred to have a lot of what we call brio, meaning they have a lot of presence, they have a lot of strength, they have a lot of boldness, they have a lot of attitude. And these are desirable qualities in these horses, but they require, a strong leader. And Lisa and I have worked together with Metro over the years. And Lisa, I have seen you on more than one occasion step up to the plate of leadership, and I have seen Metro instantly respond. You know as well as I do that he responds great to me. He a strong dominant horse needs a strong dominant leader. You have to be better at the game than they are. And primarily that starts with groundwork. And I know that confidence is, and I know you don't mind me sharing this, Lisa, but I know that confidence is a big issue for you, as it is for many people, especially many people that find themselves in a relationship with a strong and dominant horse. Look, they can be bullies and they know how to intimidate you. And this is the hard part for people to get. They know when they intimidate you. They see the change in your body language. They see you retreat. They see the fear on your face. And they then know that their actions have an effect on you. So a big part of this game is fake it until you make it. Take control of your body language. Bite off small little challenges. Like, you can't just confront this thing and say, as of today, I'm going to be the big boss leader and do everything. You're going to respond to me. You know, take small little chunks of this. Like, I just want to be able to lead him from here to there without him looking around. Or I just want him to, you know, stop when I stop. I just want to be able to circle him without him kicking out or, you know, pinning his ears at me. I just want to be able to ask him to do this one thing and have him comply. So build your strength and leadership in small amounts. And it's important when you're dealing with a dominant horse that's challenging your authority, don't ask him to do stuff you're not capable or ready to reinforce. If you cannot, the classic saying there is, if you're not going to be able to make the horse leave the barnyard, it's best you don't ask him to leave the barnyard. Because every time you ask and fail, you're training the horse to disrespect your authority. You're training the horse you have no authority. And you're training the horse that you're not a leader. So those are the things that I say. It starts from within you. It starts from you learning to have command of your body language, command of your emotionality. Look, Lisa, you should, of all people, should have this. You're a motivational speaker. You're a corporate leader. For goodness sakes, you got this. So don't let this horse bully you. He's a cool horse. He wants a strong leader. It's just that what you're up against is he is a very strong leader. And so that means you have to be even better at it than he is. And that's not an easy challenge. It's certainly not. And I get it. That confidence is a big part of that. Okay. Good morning. And Nancy finally joined your mom. Okay. Holly says, my old mare used to be boss. Now a younger mare took over and is boss and chases my mare all over the place. Look, in contrived herds, meaning the horses don't choose the herd, we choose it. And we choose it based on our convenience of how many paddocks do we have and the fences and the mares and the gillies, whatever we base our random splitting of the horses. We often end up with herds where there are no true leaders in the herd. In my opinion, beta horses are horses that most often are bullies. They don't really truly have leadership qualities, but they're bold and strong and bullies and aggressive. And so they bully other horses into dominance. And I think we have a responsibility in our contrived herd settings to not allow bully horses to terrorize other horses in the pen with him. Whether it's your horse or someone else's horse, we all as horse people have an obligation to make sure those Omega horses aren't being terrorized by a bully horse. And I would remove the bully from the herd, not the horse being terrorized. But sometimes we have to take those Omega horses and lock them up at night so they can eat without stressing about it, or so that they, you know, sometimes those horses appreciate coming into their own pen to get some relief from the more aggressive horses in the herd. Sometimes changing the dynamic of that herd by adding or removing one horse can sort out these sorts of behavioral problems within the herd. But I wouldn't just sit back and let it happen. I'd figure out a solution so that that old, particularly if it's a geriatric mare, she doesn't need to be chased around and bullied on by a younger horse. So I would stick up for her. Hiya, and children and employees do well with all these things too. Yes. Lisa, is yesterday's session recorded and available? Yes, thanks for asking. Every single daily dose I have done, which is well over a 30 now, are posted in one location on my website. Some of them are on YouTube. Some of them originated on YouTube. Some of them originated on Facebook. But they are all on Facebook now, and they are all on one page of my website. And Diana or Megan's going to throw up the link to that daily dose of horsemanship. But as I recall, the URL is signin.juliegoodnight.com. Lisa, you already have a membership, I believe. And then you type /daily-dose-of-horsemanship/. And that'll take you to the dedicated page that has all of the posts. So definitely go back and listen to yesterday's lesson. And join me every day, by the way. So I know we got to be getting down to the end here soon because I've been out this far too long. So there's information. Carmelie, thanks for sharing the information about our interactive club. I call Carmelie my number one student in the interactive program because she's so enthusiastic. She completed the entire curriculum with a lot of intention and thoughtfulness, and she took her time and really went through every assignment to its fullest. And she's our greatest cheerleader because she gets all the other members chatting around. So thank you, Carmelie, for sharing information about the club. I made amazing progress in a year. She said the interactive lessons are so helpful, and you can send videos and get personal feedback from Julie. Yep, that's the way it works. And you get a orchestrated set of assignments and exercises to do with your horse and the study resource materials that go with those assignments. Michelle, our fjord gelding will not keep his lips to himself when the farrier is working on him. He will lip the lead rope or my hand. He doesn't do this any other time because he knows I won't smack him when the farrier has his foot. How do I correct this without making him jump, putting the farrier at risk? Well, let's see. Did you say how old this horse is? Look, young horses are busy with their mouths. They explore the world with their mouths, and it's wrong. You don't, and absolutely very, very basic fundamental manner is he doesn't get his lips put his lips on you, and he most definitely does not get to put his lips on the farrier. And so if we start with the very basic ground manner that you must keep your nose in front of your chest at all times I'm working with you, that is the rule that you need to reinforce constantly. You need to take the time to reinforce it strictly in a setting away from the farrier so that the horse is trained and he knows that he has to keep his nose in front of his chest. If I have a young horse working and a farrier has been down underneath him, and I might have him tied to the hitching rail, but I might be holding the lead as well, or maybe I have the lead just wrapped around the hitching rail and I'm holding it, or maybe I'm just holding the horse. I want to step away from him, but make sure he follows the rule, keeps his nose in front of his chest. If that lead rope's hanging down in front of him and he starts playing with it with his nose, and that is keeping him distracted while the farrier does his job, and he's not looking around and he's not putting his lips on me, I'm probably just going to let that go because he's keeping his nose in front of his chest, he's not destroying anything, and he's keeping distracted from the farrier. A lot of times horses, particularly young horses, need to keep their mouth busy. So I won't be afraid to gesture at him with my finger if I think he's doing something wrong, or correct him with a little tap of a stick or the lead rope, slow, you know, just like I'm warning you. But he has to know and understand what my expectation is first. And that kind of training happens away from the farrier. So if the horse learns that you're not going to correct him because of the circumstance he's in, like a farrier underneath him or a rider on top of him or something like that, that's a terrible thing when a horse learns that, but sometimes clever horses do. So we need to set up a training scenario. You need to talk to your farrier and say, look, I got to nip this thing in the bud. I'm going to let him reach around and touch you, but I'm going to spank him really hard for it so you get out of the way. You know, so set up a training scenario with your farrier. But deal with those manners outside of the farrier and then carry that expectation by sort of, you know, intimidating the horse by looking at him and pointing your finger at him when he's acting that way. Okay. You're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. Molly and Ike from Oregon. Good morning, Molly. Another one of my interactive members. We've been working with old Ike for a while now. And you are welcome. Why would anyone use that mousetrap? Well, you know, this is stuff that goes back, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of years. So there are many things about horsemanship that are steeped in thousands of years of tradition. And so sometimes these traditions take time to overturn. And I believe education is a way to do that, not judgment and criticism. I might have been just a little bit judgmental and critical a minute ago, but I don't blame the person for their lack of understanding. Of my three horses, one is trained. We've been together about 3 years now. I was out with an injury for about a year of it and didn't ride. In between, we moved, so now I have them on my place instead of boarded with regular lessons. I tried trailering 1-2 lessons here last fall. The instructor had a very different style from my previous ones who were more like you. I think it's important that you have a connection with your instructor, that there is a certain chemistry, that you have the same philosophies and beliefs and goals, and that you have an instructor that is supportive of your goals. If you're in a high performance situation, you have a high level, high performance show horse or competitive horse, you might have to find a trainer where you fit into their program because they're at a really high level of performance. But otherwise, we expect our instructors and our trainers to be there for us, and to be someone you like, you look up to, you want to spend time with, and who has values that you share. Certainly, safety is a big factor. That's why I'm a part of the Certified Horsemanship Association. We promote all those ideals and certify riding instructors along those lines. So if you're looking for an instructor in your area, I'd encourage you to go to chainstructors.com. And you can literally search CHA certified instructors and know that they come with an objective stamp of approval that they have safe, fun, and effective riding lessons. So, okay, oops. The question is, my horse knows me and won't lope because I'm afraid to lope. My seat tightens. How do I change that? So once again, just like I was saying to Lisa, the other Lisa, Lisa Gunther, you need to address this as a confidence level. Look, you're not going to get any horse to canter for you until you at least have enough confidence to prove to the horse that you want to canter. Because a lot of times when people are dealing with a lack of confidence and a fear of cantering, they constantly telegraph that fear and doubt to the horse. And the last thing that horse is going to do is canter when you don't really want to. And so you have to address this first emotionally from a confidence level. There is a lot of information on my website about building confidence with horses. One of my earliest daily doses of horsemanship homework had to do with confidence. I have a training audio on confidence. I've done a lot of podcasts on the subject. All of that, the podcasts are free. I recommend people look into Barbara Schulte. She has a lot of information on confidence with horses. But unless and until you address that within yourself, you're not going to be able to accomplish that goal on the horse. Also, it's very, very important people understand that another really important tenet of classical horsemanship, this is wisdom that goes back thousands of years, tells us that, and I quote here, the best way to improve the canter is to improve the trot. When you have accomplished everything there is to accomplish at the trot, cantering will seem like nothing. So you need to learn to ride the trot standing, sitting, and posting. You need to learn to ride all speeds at the trot, slow, collected, sitting trot, up to the extended trot, working trot, be able to transition between all of those things, be able to do circles and serpentines at the trot, collected trot, extended trot, lengthening and shortening of stride. There are so many skills to accomplish at the trot, which is, by the way, a harder gait to ride in many cases, for many horses. So when you have accomplished everything there is to accomplish at the trot, you will have the confidence to canter. But you need to work on your confidence. Only you can do that. I can give you the tools, and they're all over my website. But you have to do the work to build that confidence. So I encourage you to check that out. I know hundreds, literally hundreds of people that have followed these steps and gained the confidence to canter or jump or trail ride, whatever it is that they were lacking. So go check that out. Carmelie commenting on her Myler bit. She said, I really appreciated the personal assistance from Mr. Myler on finding the right one. You know, thanks for bringing that up, Carmelie, because this is really important for people to understand. The Myler brothers have dedicated their lives to making bits better for horses. One of them's a horse trainer, one of them's a mechanical engineer, and one of them is Dale. He's the glue that makes everything stick together. And when you go to my website, and Diana will put up the link, and you click on the bidding questionnaire, that information that you fill out, it's just a simple questionnaire about your horse, Dale Myler reads that, and in many cases he picks up the phone and calls you and talks to you about your horse and what his needs are. He doesn't care if he sells a bit or not. In fact, he won't be the one that even sells you the bits. Toklat is the company that handles their worldwide distribution. They're not even involved in the selling back and forth of the bits. He will recommend the best thing for your bit, and in many cases he says leave the bit you've got. What you've got is probably the best thing for your horse. So that is a free service that is there because they basically have the same philosophy as me, and they just want to help horses one human at a time. So if they can help you out, they will. So be sure to check that out. Thanks for mentioning that, Carmelie. Can I get the benefit of the interactive membership if I do not have an arena or round pen? Oh yeah, absolutely. All the assignments are written to be, shall we say, accommodating of the type of horse you have, the kind of riding you do, the facility you're working out of. Like for instance, there are no round pen assignments. There might be a video for you to watch so you understand, let's say, a certain concept that I'm trying to come across with. But other than, you know, a lot of people are doing the assignments out on a ranch. Carmelie did a lot of it without much of a facility behind her at all. So great question. Thanks for asking. Also, for people that are horseless, or maybe you don't own a horse, you only take lessons, I tried to design it to be accommodating to that. Or if your horse maybe went lame, Elizabeth Owens can speak to this, and there was a period of time that you could not ride, there are assignments where you are just studying behavior or concepts or observations, herd observations, stuff like that. So even if you're not actively riding right now, you can still benefit from the membership. Okay, Carmelie, the barn I was at for 9 months at the time didn't have either. Good. When your horse is an alpha in the herd, will he or she be the alpha with you? Yeah, so if you're... So that horse hits the ground with his temperament. And, you know, there's a nature versus nurture argument to be had. instinct versus learned behavior to be had on dominant behavior and aggressive behavior in horses. However, those truly alpha horses, the brave, bold, strong, dominant horses, they were probably born and not created. And so if you have a horse that is very strongly alpha in nature, he's very dominant in his behavior, yes, he takes a very dominant handler. I like to say, because I've handled a lot of very dominant horses in my career, I get along well with them. I've handled a lot of stallions in my career, so that's part of it. But I like to say that the most dominant horse in the world will gladly accept the subordinate role as long as you can prove that your leadership skills are better than his. So that means you are confident and you make really good decisions. You're not afraid to reinforce your decisions. And you have good judgment at all times. And if the horse believes himself to be all of that, you have to do a better job at it. And you have to sometimes prove to him that you're willing to stand up for your convictions. So they tend to be more challenging, and they are far less tolerant of your mistakes. That's probably where people get in the most trouble with really dominant horses. So when you make a lot of mistakes with them in handling, they can sometimes become increasingly disdainful and increasingly aggressive because they're losing patience and tolerance with you. So these are dynamics that can be very dangerous and unpleasant. So sometimes we look at a dynamic between a horse and its owner and or its rider, and we come to understand that it is not a good dynamic, because temperament to temperament, these two individuals are not a good match. And so we need to reboot that situation to find a more appropriate match, more suitable match for horse and rider, for both the horse's benefit and the horse and the rider's benefit. Okay, what are your thoughts on a cavesson? Look, a plain cavesson goes around the nose of the horse, halfway between the bottom of the cheekbone and the corner of his mouth, and you have 2 inches of slack under the chin. Not 2 inches, but 2 finger widths. So it is a plain cavesson on an English bridle, properly adjusted, does nothing to your horse but convey a traditional piece of equipment. It is harmless. And you should use it because that's expected. It's a required piece of English equipment. When we talk about strapping the mouth shut, a drop nose cavesson or a cavesson that comes below the mouthpiece of the bit, that's a something altogether different. It is disallowed in many forms of competition. And that's what we were talking about. So if you're just talking about plain cavesson, should be like a 1 inch thickness, and two fingers of looseness around the nose, use it. It looks nice. It sets off the look of the horse's head, and it has a traditional English look. So nothing wrong with using that. Would you be able to recommend a store where I can purchase one? Well, look, hey, I'd like for you all to go out to your local tack stores when they reopen and support independent and feed stores. There are fewer and fewer of them, and they're farther and farther between. But a lot of us don't have that locale. There's no real mom and pop tack shop anywhere near me. I'm a big fan of some of the tack shops up in the Denver area. Latigo is one I really like. And there's a store in Fort Collins. I think it's an awesome tack store. And also in the Boulder area, in the, certainly in the South Denver area. So I would support your local tack dealers. But we, you know, these days, let's face it, a lot of our stuff comes from online. So lots of great online tack dealers, Valley Vet, you know, State Line. I don't know about State Line if they're still online operation, but you know, Dover Saddlery for the English stuff on the little bit higher end. I like if I'm going to buy tack, I'm going to buy a quality piece of tack. So I look to them for the higher end stuff. But there's plenty of places. I would buy the entire English bridle in one package. It'll come with the cavesson. Training cavesons sometimes get interchanged in the English bridle, but most of the time the bridle is sold as an entire set minus the bit. So it'll be the headstall, brow band, nose band, and reins all matching. I just started learning to ride an English saddle. How far down do you put your heels compared to Western? So, interesting question you got there. So here's the deal, Stephanie. If you are riding hunt seat, so there's different disciplines within the discipline of English, and hunt seat riding implies that you are going to, at some point in time, be going over jumps. So hunt seat riding is specifically for the purpose of jumping horses, in which case you have maximum heels down and maximum pronation in your feet so that you give a real strong anchor down on that horse's back. However, if what you're riding is dressage, and you ride with a long length of stirrup, and we want our leg to be very soft and rhythmic and flowy with the horse's movement, we're going to use a lot less heel down, and it's going to be more like Western or pleasure riding. But the truth is, how much heel down and how much pronation or locking of your foot in that position relates to the activity that you're doing on the horse. The more dramatic and arduous and wild that activity, the more heel down you want, because the more anchor you need on the horse's back. So there's a short course on heels down. Okay. Panicure. Yes, thank you. God, that was driving me crazy. The Panicure Power Pack is what I was talking about earlier. Thank you for that. Not Pyrantel, no. And definitely the Panicure Power Pack. Okay, can you talk about head tossing and why the response? New behavior when haltering or pulling on the fly mask. Okay, if head tossing is only happening when the horse is bridled, it has entirely to do with the horse's discomfort in the bit. And so if that bit is hanging down on his tongue and bothering him a lot, he'll start tossing his head to throw that bit up in the air. And then, and when he does that, he momentarily gets a release. So it's a self-rewarding behavior. If your horse is tossing his head as you're getting ready to do something with him, that is a defiant gesture. He's just saying, no, I don't want that. No, I don't want you to do that. I would just ignore it and go about what you do. This is one reason I train horses to drop their head on command from a cue from me, from the halter. A lot of benefit to that, and that was one of my earlier daily doses with Mr. Woodrow, was to teach him to drop his head on command. Particularly helpful when you have a horse that's prone to emotional outbursts. My horse Pepperoni does that a lot when it's something he doesn't like I'm getting ready to tighten the cinch or getting ready to put the bridle on, whatever. He'll just give me one or two of these, you know, throw the head up. I just ignore it and kind of wait for him to get, you know, just... I just ignore it and go about my business. I might ask him to drop his head down to the ground to sort of settle him and do not react to a horse's emotional outbursts. Don't let his defiant behavior alter your course of action. And if the horse does not benefit from his gestures and antics, it will go away. So that's generally the best way to handle emotional behavior in horses. Good question. I don't know what you're laughing at, Jeannie. Oh, Jeannie, I love you. You are always laughing. I know that. And I'm probably laughing at some subtle joke I made. Okay, contact the rescue. Thank you, Sharon, for moderating that comment. Okay. It's like we never took that improv class. Okay, I feel like I'm getting... I just turned the camera around. Sorry, let's see. How do I get that back? There we go. Do you have bot flies out there? know. Isn't that great? I don't. They do in some areas of Colorado, but I guess it's too cold maybe where we live, or too high altitude. We don't get them. I did in Florida, though. I grew up with them. And my horses are low shedders, but we hit them with Quest Plus once a year. Yeah, excellent. Thanks for reminding me of that. And, you know, Quest is a great deworming product it's a good one to rotate in with your ivermectin once a year, depending on, you know, whatever your overall worming program is. Occasionally rotate with the Panacure Power Pack, and occasionally rotate with Quest. That way you make sure you're getting the full array of parasites. And once a year, so the bot flies, the Quest will get right into that. And I do remember that I liked using those abrasive bricks to scrape the bot fly eggs off their legs. And you can buy those as grooming. They're grooming tools, actually, that work great for that. So, Lisa, when you start a colt and they're walk, trot, and loping well, what do you start working on next? So we start working on refinement of cues. You know, one of the next things you want to start working on specifically and more deliberately is your canter departure. So start making that a lot more controlled from a slow trot. And then we start working from the walk. You want to start working on collection at some point, but not until the horse is really, really moving forward well. We start working on lengthening and shortening of stride, bending. We want to start doing circles and turns. I want to start introducing shoulder control, hip control. I'm bringing that in as early as possible. Get that horse moving off your leg. I like to work on arcing first and then a little more shoulder control. I generally bring in hip control later because it's easy and it's an easier thing to control. So I don't have to spend a lot of emphasis on that. So just little, bit by bit, start introducing new experiences, going out on the trail, hauling to new arenas to ride in a strange location, adding to the horse's actual experience, life experiences. Start going over some obstacles, simple little obstacles that challenge that horse's direction. Say, you know, sometimes I'm going to ask you to go into an obstacle that you might not like, but this furthers our relationship. This furthers my authority over the horse. I promise you, horse, I will never put you into a situation you can't handle. So you need to trust me here. I trust that you can walk over that pole laying on the ground without getting hurt. And so you start developing more and more communication between you and the horse, more trust, experiences, and experiences in different locations. Daily doses are likely stored in the video section on this Facebook page. Yeah, I think all of them have been posted to Facebook, even the YouTube videos. Okay, surely getting down to the bottom here. I'm buying a new horse in June. I have the sales, and I have perused catalogs. Okay, you know what sales you're going to go to, hoping they happen. And you've looked at the catalogs. I've chosen some horses I think are right for me. I would like to ask you for some tips or guidance as I have bought a horse at a sale. As I haven't bought a horse at a sale. All of mine have been purchased from people I knew. Okay, buying a horse at a sale comes with a great deal of risk. I buy a lot of horses at performance horse sales because I know what I'm looking for, I know what I'm looking at, and I love that that challenge. I love shopping for horses. So, first of all, look at the quality of the sale. It sounds like you've already done that. Make sure you are talking about a sale that has some sort of criteria to get into it, like these are trained horses, they're a certain type of like their cow horses or their ranch horses or something. And then you go through the catalog and, you know, for me, I generally am shopping for geldings. So I rule out horses first. So I go through the catalog once to find horses that fall within the age bracket I'm looking for, which is generally 8 to 12. I want to know if they have the training and experience I'm looking for, the breeding, the confirmation. I know that the horse that I select out of those catalogs is the same horse everybody else that's coming to that sale is picking out of that catalog. The best horses rise to the top. The best horses are the ones that all the buyers are bidding on. So once I get to that sale, I want to have a lot of time. As soon as those horses are on property, I want to be there to start looking at them. If they'll let you ride them, fine. At many horse sales, they'll let you ride the horse first. Sometimes you can't. So I want to talk to the seller of that horse, get as much background, get as much history, watch them ride the horse before I ride the horse. Double check what I thought I saw in the pictures of the catalog to make sure that is all indeed true. He's straight legged, his confirmation's good, his temperament is good, and his training is where I thought it was. I'm going to look at the position of that horse in the auction, because we all know that the first couple of horses don't sell well, the last horses don't sell well. If that horse is a horse I kind of like and he's in a bad position in the sale, I might have more chance of getting that horse than if he's in a prime location in the sale, in the middle of the sale, and there's going to be 100 people bidding on him. I want to have a number of horses selected, because chances are I won't be able to buy all the horses I like, because you know, it only takes one other bidder with deep pockets that's determined to buy that horse in an auction situation, and you're not going to get it. I always set an upper limit on what I think I can afford to pay for that horse. And then be careful. If you don't have a lot of experience judging horse flesh, judging horse's temperament, judging a horse's soundness, I don't recommend buying at auction. And in a lot of the high-level performance horse sales, you can get pre-purchase veterinary exams done on the horse. Some of them even require that the horses have x-rays in their library, and you can have your vet look at the horse's x-rays. So there's a lot of precautions you can take there. So in a nutshell, that's what I would say. Hard to catch article. Thank you for posting that. Molly, where would I post my schedule for next week? I don't even know what my schedule is going to be tomorrow. But I've kind of been falling into a routine of being here at the lake for half the week and being home half the week. So I'm doing I don't have an adequate internet connection to do the live posts at home. So I'm doing my arena lessons when I'm home and live posts here. I don't know yet what my schedule is going to entail, because I guess we're still on this shutdown thing. But every day is a new experience for me. But I think that I will probably be doing the same thing next week that I did this week, and do my live post in the middle of the week, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. So you can kind of be looking for that schedule. But I'll be sure and post them the day before, so you'll know when I do get a live post scheduled. I knew that instructor didn't have to be stuck on me loping, that there are lots of other things we could do. Good. Yeah. Okay. I didn't get the questionnaire when I clicked the link, the website with his video on it. The link just posted here works. So yeah, there's a couple of different links on that webpage of mine. And one is a video of Dale Myler talking about their theory in designing bits for horses, and what horses hate most about bits and what horses like most about bits, and about all the problems that bits can cause. And so that is a PowerPoint presentation that Dale Myler does, and it's just simply educational. The link to the bidding questionnaire is a different link, and it's posted up here. So that should just take you right to a little online form that you fill out. I think the Myler bit mouthpiece that I've been talking about most on these live posts is the 33. You can get it in a snaffle, you can get it in a curb, you can get it in the combination bit. But it is kind of the ultimate mouthpiece for horses. It is not for green, young, or inexperienced horses, but for that mature, trained horse is a godsend. Okay, link problems. I've experienced finding the interactive link on your site a couple of times, couldn't find it. Could you post it again? It's a year-long membership in the interactive program. The reason why is because this is a long-term endeavor, and I'm really only interested in working with students who have a long-term commitment to this endeavor. So it's a year-long commitment. It's $299 to join, and you just get everything when you join, and you work through at your own pace. And for some people, they're on multiple years of membership in order to complete the entire curriculum. Other people have been able to get through the curriculum, like Carmelie, in 12, 13 months. And we're working on additional curriculum for those eager beavers like Carmelie. And so that's how it works. And the link is simply signin.juliegoodnight.com. You have to join, pay the fee, and then you get you'll create a login. So it's a private side of the website you're not able to see until you actually join. So I'm sure somebody will throw up. How often do we interact? I do it every single day. Most of my students aren't on there every day. A lot of my students only maybe interact with me once a week or less. I have students that might go a month or two without any interaction, and then we're conversing every day because a problem has occurred or whatever. So the interaction, what you get out of this program is what you put into it. But I grade assignments and check messages every day. Okay. Do we send videos of our test results or answer in the interactive command? Yeah. So a lot of the earlier assignments in the academy have to do with evaluating your horse, evaluating yourself, creating goals, evaluating your horse's training history, creating a training plan. And one of the earlier assignments involves you making a video of you riding in a certain pattern, just walk, trot, canter. And then you first review the video yourself, and then you send me a link to the video and I review it. But first I want you to look at it, and I want you to analyze it based on the criteria that we laid out in the assignment. And then oftentimes, if you're experiencing a problem with your horse, it might not have anything to do with the curriculum we're working on, but you run into a problem with your horse, I might ask you to send me a video to try to get it on video so I can see what's going on there. So yeah, there's a lot of sharing of video too. Okay, I'm going to say we got to be getting to the bottom here because it's time to go. I'm still seeing a connection, but I know I've been at this for a couple hours now, and I can only go so long before I got to take a break, if you know what I mean. I've drank a whole bottle of water after a whole pot of coffee. So, sorry about the break, the disconnects today. I didn't mean to ask about a calves, and I meant to ask your opinion about hackamore. Okay. Well, that's different. Again, there's a lot of hackamores out there. Some of them are great. Some of them are not so great. Some of them are downright brutal. But a simple hackamore or a humane mechanical hackamore are fine. Lots of horses do better in a hackamore. They're not better and they're not worse. They're a lot like bits in that potential for abuse lies in the hands of the rider, not on the bit of the horse. So I am going to do a lesson one of these days on bits, but I need to have some bits that I can show you or figure out how to use some additional media here. And so then we'll do some lessons on bits, and that'll maybe answer some more of your questions about the hackamore. So I ride in a Dr. Cook bitless bridle or a nurtural bridle. I'm happy with it, but I wonder if I am missing anything without a bit. No, as long as you have adequate stopping control with your horse and directional control with a bitless bridle, there's nothing wrong with it. What you run into are limitations in training horses to do high level maneuvers. And, but I would say many, if not most people are never going to do that anyway. So that's the only thing you're missing. I like to say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. If you're getting along well with your horse now and whatever bridle type of bridle you're using, and he's happy with it and you're happy with it, keep doing that. Hello. Where schedule? But where do you post? I haven't found prior posts yet, and I don't want to miss them. They're all on my website. They're all on Facebook. All the live posts have been through Facebook. We've done all. They're all on. Many of them are on my YouTube channel as well. So there's a lot of different places you can access this. But they're all on one page of my website. The link is here in the comments, and it's at signin.juliegoodnight.com/daily-dose-of-horsemanship/, and you'll find all the posts, and there's well over 30 of them now. Bidding questionnaire posts, there's the link you needed, Molly. Okay, for the next live post, will probably be next Tuesday for the next live post. Let's just say we're going to go Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday next week. Argentine snaffle. What can I tell you about the Argentine snaffle? I'm going to save that for my bidding discussion rather than get into a whole new subject here 2 hours after we started. So thanks for that. I'm going to write that down to talk about when we talk about bids, that and the hackamore. And 10 a.m. mountain time is the best time so far. Can you do more than one horse with a person on the interactive? Yes. Thanks for asking that, Lisa. I have many members who have multiple horses. And if you go to the trouble to do these assignments with each of your horses and report back on each horse, I will go to the trouble to read all about them and make my comments. So again, this is all what you put into it. If you have multiple horses, it's really going to be great because you'll find different exercises. Some horses will breeze through one exercise, but you might have a horse that really needs that exercise. So you get even more out of it. So you get out of it whatever you put into it. 28-year-old horse, do you recommend supplements for arthritis? Yes, absolutely. Cosequin. And I would just, on a 28-year-old horse that is retired, I would definitely have him on Cosequin. I would probably just use the basic Cosequin formula. It's the most cost effective. I don't think you need all the fancy bells and whistles. Like I feed my performance horses Cosequin ASU. It has some added ingredients that sort of boost the effectiveness of the glucosamine, which is the primarily active ingredient. But with an older horse that's retired that you're just trying to keep comfortable, I think you get the most bang for your buck out of just the basic Cosequin formula. And we put those horses on a loading dose in the beginning, so they're getting it twice a day. Then after a couple of weeks, you can take them back to a once-a-day dose. So, you are welcome, everyone. I finally made it to the bottom. Hallelujah. Thanks for all the great questions. Thank you guys for joining me. I can't believe there's still 60 people on here after all that time. So I really appreciate you guys joining me. Be sure to share this with your friends. Hit like, do all that stuff that boosts this post so other horse lovers just like you can find this information. And maybe learn a little something about their horse, and that'll sure help me out as well. So thank you guys for joining me. Be sure to check out my website, juliegoodnight.com. Go to the educational side of my website, signin.juliegoodnight.com. Love you guys. I'll come at you tomorrow with a arena lesson with a horse, and then I will come back at you live next week. So thanks for joining me. Be safe, be smart. I'll see you next time.